Well, turn if you would to Exodus chapter 10. Exodus chapter 10, as we continue our study in the book of Exodus on the four compromises Pharaoh gives to Moses, the people of God. Let's pray before we look at the fourth compromise. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do ask thee for grace and mercy. Thank you for allowing us to worship you. Thank you for allowing us to sing songs and praise you and magnify you. Because you are a great God, the Almighty One. And what love that you have bestowed upon us that we may know the Lord Jesus Christ in spirit and truth. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you haven't left us alone. You have given us not only thy Son, but you have given us the Word of God, that special revelation, the inspired Word of God. And you have preserved it. So this morning, we don't have to walk in darkness. We don't have to be ignorant of your Word or your precepts or who you are and what you have done and what you're going to do. So Father, this morning we do ask that you would bless the preaching and teaching of the Word of God. Give me grace, give me strength, fill me with the Holy Spirit, direct and guide me, give me words, give me understanding, insight. But for all of us this morning, Father, we would hear the Word of God. That we would, looked at a while ago, Father, about, oh, that we might have a heart to obey the Word of God. Oh, that Israel had a heart to obey. So, Lord, help us this morning. You know our infirmities. You know where we fail. Lord, but you also know that we do love you. We do want you to be glorified. We do want to live for your glory. Forgive us where we fail. But, Lord, give us grace that we might be more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. So, bless now, we pray, and may you be exalted. Minister to thy people, O Lord, through the word of God. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we take a quick review on these compromises, because you'll see that they're kind of joined together. First of all, number one, Pharaoh says, go sacrifice in the land. And we said the world says, where shall you worship God? And the world kind of has an answer. Well, in the state churches, really, in the places that we allow you to worship. You see, state-controlled worship, state-controlled churches, they say, well, they'll let us do this. They'll allow us to worship in the land. That was the first problem, first compromise. The second compromise was, Pharaoh says, ye shall not go very far. Now, the world says, this is how you're going to worship God. You see, in moderation, not in extremes, no fat fanatics. You can't take your religion that serious, you know. It's okay to be religious, but don't take it too far. You see, you can worship God with your mind. That's what we call dead orthodoxy. Or you could worship God with like some say, pure emotions. You know, we could run the aisles, we can sing all day long, we could put our hands up. There's nothing wrong with that. We'll talk about that tonight. But you see, it turns into hysteria. Turns into out of control emotions. You see, but it says, don't dare worship God in spirit and in truth. So the second compromise is this. You shall not go very far. The third compromise is this. Pharaoh says, who shall worship? Who shall worship? The world says, it's okay for you to be religious, but don't force it on your children. Don't infect your children with all this Lord Jesus stuff. See, all these commandments, all these things about holiness and purity. You see, the state says, we own your children, and you can't do that. Is that true? Does the state own our children? Who shall worship? The fourth and final compromise is found in Exodus chapter 10, 24 through 26. Let's read that. Exodus 10, verse 24 through 26. And Pharaoh called unto Moses and said, go ye, serve the Lord. Only let your flocks and your herds be stayed. Let your little ones also go with you. And Moses said, Thou must give us also sacrifices and burnt offerings, that we may sacrifice unto the Lord our God. Our cattle also shall go with us. There shall not a hoof be left behind, for thereof must we take to serve the Lord our God, and we know not what with what we must serve the Lord until we come hither. And so there's the fourth compromise there. And you think about this for a minute. Pharaoh is really not in a place to make a deal. To make a deal. This is the ninth plague. Has destroyed Egypt. Now, we haven't gone through the plagues individually, but I don't want you to miss this, okay? This is a desperate man. You say his cabinet has already told him, you know, get rid of this guy Moses. And you see, Pharaoh is a desperate man, and he's not in a position to say anything or make a deal or make a bargain. You see, economically, Egypt is ruined. Materially, everything has been destroyed. I mean, from the trees, to fruit, the cattle. The Egyptians have been afflicted. Their morale. their self-will, their pride. You see, they're broken. They're broken. But notice here, see the stubbornness of a sinner's heart. Rather suffer the judgments of God than just get right with God. That's how we are. That's how Pharaoh is. You see, and the question is, why have all these bad things happened to me? Well, maybe God is trying to humble you. Maybe God is trying to break you. See, the Lord is saying, submit, submit. And we as sinners, before we were saved, we'd say, no way am I going to submit. I'm going to enjoy my sin no matter if the house burns down or I go, you know, I'm in the hospital, I'm on my bed sick. Doesn't matter. You see, that's the heart of Pharaoh there. See, Pharaoh's holding out. And God is hardening his heart all the while. This fourth compromise. Again, Pharaoh says, what shall you worship your God? What shall you, with what? And what will you worship? What will you take? What will you use to worship God? With what will you worship God? Does that sound familiar? Think for a minute. One day, in the wilderness, the Lord Jesus was confronted by the devil. Matthew chapter 4. Let me read that to you for a minute. See if it rings a bell. Matthew 4 verse 8. Again, the devil taketh him up into a exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And saith unto him, all these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then said Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. And then the devil leaveth him, and behold, the angels came and ministered unto him. Look at verse 9 again. It says, and said unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. In this compromise, okay, let's look at some questions here. First of all, who owns all these things we possess? Well, we would say, does God own them? Well, Satan is saying he owns everything. We see we say we own these things. The state says they own all of it. That's the first question. Who owns all these things we possess? Number two, in what way am I to serve God with these things? See, Moses says we need these flocks. We need the cattle. We need offerings and sacrifices and burnt offerings in the service of God, the free will offer, all the things that he's going to learn when he gets to that place there in Sinai. 3 days' journey. In what way am I to serve God with these things? That's the second question. Number three is the warning. The warning is we can't take it with us. I was reading some quotes that I put in the bulletin. one by John Piper. You never see a U-Haul behind a hearse, right? You'll never see a U-Haul behind a hearse. We can have an inheritance and leave it for our children. And like the preacher says, you know, or the proverb says, our children will what? Spend it as fast and recklessly. All my labors, all that I work for, my children just swander in that sense. So the third question is, we can't take it with you. There's a warning. In a sense, a statement, a warning. We can't take it with us. Let's look at the first question. Who owns all these things we possess? Well, if you remember in Psalm 50, I like that verse. It says Psalm 50, verse 10 and 11. Who owns all these things we possess? The Lord says, for every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle upon a thousand hills. I know all the fowls of the mountains, and the wild beasts of the field are mine. See, God owns everything. I remember one man was in a prayer request. Well, God, why don't you sell some of those cattle and cash them in so I can pay my debt? Since you owe all the cattle on a thousand hills, it's all yours, God. And he does. There's a couple of verses, I didn't write them down, but there's one verse that talks about how he will take the wicked, he'll take the money, the wealth from the wicked, and give it to his people. God will provide in many, many different ways. Psalm 24:1 says this, the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world, and they that dwell therein. And then in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 26 and 28, this is the talking about idols, food, offering to idols, things like that. The Apostle Paul says, For the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof. But if any man say unto you, this is offered in sacrifice unto idols, eat not for this sake that showed it, and for conscience sake, for the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof. You see, everything, God owns it all. God owns it all. You see, in these verses in Psalm 50, God is not happy with Israel's worship. There's the ritualism, there's mechanicalism, there's a form of godliness, denying the power thereof. They're going through the motions, and they're offering all these sacrifices as if God needed them. God says, no, I don't need them. I own it anyway. Verse 10, God has loaned it to us. For every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle upon a thousand hills. I know all the fowls of the mountains, and the wild beasts of the field are mine. You see, God has loaned it to us. This is the very truth that we face this morning in the matter of redemption. You see, Israel's not redeemed yet. She's going to be redeemed. And she's going to be brought out of Egypt. She's been brought before Mount Sinai. There she's going to serve. There she's going to sacrifice. And there she's going to have that feast. Okay? But you see, we can look back now as a matter of redemption and say, God has redeemed us. Who owns us this morning? Do you own yourself? Or does God own you? See, the Lord Jesus purchased you. If you're a Christian this morning, you are in the slave market of sin. You're on death row. The Lord Jesus says, I'm going to purchase this one. I'm going to purchase this one. And that's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6:19. Let me read it. What? Know ye not that your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own? And he goes on to say, you're bought with a price. See, the precious blood of Christ was that ransom price that purchased you. You see, your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, and you just can't live like you used to live, right? Your master is now the Lord Jesus Christ. You've been bought. I love that. Think of that for a minute. You know, I often say that, you know, forgiveness of sins is great, isn't it? To have my past, present, and future sins all gone. They'll never be brought up to me again. Now, the devil will try, right? My own conscience sometimes will bring it up. But see, the other part of salvation is deliverance from sin. You see, Jesus Christ is my Lord and Master. He's calling the shots. He owns me. You see, you know what that means? He's responsible. He's accountable to take care of me. And he says, I can do that. I will do that. Infinitely, I will do that. And so this morning, who owns all these things we possess? Well, first of all, God does. And he even owns you. He owns you. Now, God has called us to be good stewards of all that he has given to us. Isn't that true? Now, the environmentalists and all this stuff, you know, you don't care about the earth, you don't care about... Yeah, I care about the earth. I don't worship the earth. I don't worship the animals as... You see, when they talk about animals and all that, and all this, you know, they're basically... It's rehashed Hinduism. Okay, reincarnation, worshiping animals, worshiping the earth, idolatry, pantheism. You know, there's nothing new under the sun. It's just rehashed old idolatry given a different name. So I'm going to go that far, but I realize that we are to be good stewards. Let's look at that for a minute. Look at Genesis chapter 1. Way back in the beginning. Genesis chapter 1. You see, God owns everything. He's loaned it to us. And he says, I want you to be a good steward. A good steward. Genesis 1, verse 26 through 31. And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful, and multiply, replenish the earth, subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. And then we'll leave it at that. But you see, again, God says, I have given you dominion, Adam. You shall subdue it. You are to be a steward of all that I give to you. After the flood, in Genesis chapter 9, this is reinstated again. In verse 2, chapter 9, chapter 1, and God blessed Noah and his sons, and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, replenish the earth, and the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth, and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth, and upon all the fishes of the sea, unto your hand are they delivered. And again, the idea is the dominion you have subdued. See, God had given Adam that responsibility. And dear ones, this morning, we have that same responsibility. You see, God owns everything. God has loaned these things to us. And now we are to be good stewards. Now, what about Satan's there in Matthew 4, verse 9? All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Well, you see, what happened is that Adam forfeited, he relinquished his right to rule in sinning in the garden. Adam forfeited, he relinquished, he gave that scepter, as it were, to Satan and said, okay, since I'm going to do it your way, Satan, I'm now going to submit unto you. And that's what's happened to us. See, Satan... Adam walked right into it. He opened his eyes were open. He wasn't deceived. No, he chose to follow Satan's way. And by doing that, he gave that dominion and that right to Satan. But the good news this morning is the Lord Jesus gained it back, right? He gained it back. On the cross, he gained back the right to rule as a result of his death on the cross. In Galatians 2:5 or 2:15, it says this. It's a good verse. It says, that having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them, openly triumphing over them in it. What does that mean? Well, on the cross, the Lord Jesus says, he's on the cross. You see, he's regaining what Adam threw away, and much more. Okay, but this idea of spoiling principalities and powers, that's Satan. He made a show of them openly, triumphant over them in it. And the idea is when a conquering general would be coming in, he's conquered the foes of this other country, And he's coming in for the victorious or victory parade. And there he is. He's in the white horse and he's coming. And what's behind him? Well, it's all the generals or the emperors, the leaders of this country that he's conquered. And he's bringing all the possessions. He's world Satan. And part of that was possession, was that we were in bondage. We were bound by him in a way, in a legal way, because Adam threw it away. Now the Lord Jesus regains it and much more. The Lord Jesus is the rightful heir of the world. Now we've been doing the reading through the book of Revelation for family worship and family time. And we see in the book of Revelation, what is that? Well, it's when the Lord Jesus is going to take back the world by force. You see, he has the title deed. He has the deed. And you see, there's these usurpers, squatters, as it were, Satan and the world. They don't want to submit to the Lord Jesus. But you see, he's going to come back, and through all the judgments, the great tribulation period, he is going to gain the world back by force. And then in Revelation 19, we see the Lord Jesus coming back on the white horse. See, that's all the result of Calvary. And finally, it's being put into effect. The Lord Jesus is the rightful heir of the world. It is part of his inheritance. And part of that inheritance we enjoy now, not only to come. So the question is, who owns everything? Well, God does. But he also owns you. He owns everything. And he's given these things to us on loan. Now, let's go to the second question. In what way am I to serve God with these things? You see, Pharaoh's compromise was this. Let's look at that. 10:24. Exodus 10:24. Pharaoh says, "Go ye, serve the Lord." Look at it. Pharaoh's giving Moses permission. That's just ironic. I mean, it's just, "Go ye, serve the Lord. Only let your flocks and your herds be stayed. Let your little ones also go with you." You remember the third compromise? He said, who's going to worship God? Who's going to go? And Pharaoh says, let the men go. You leave your families and your children behind. Well, see, Pharaoh's now convinced that, oh, you can leave your little ones go too. You can take your family. You can take your little ones. You men, you can go, but you just leave your flocks, your herds, all that, your animals, your possessions. Leave your possessions behind. You go worship the Lord. Now, think of this just a practical way. How far will the nation of Israel go on an empty stomach? You say, not very far. Not very far at all. If you consider how many thousands of people, millions, or what the number is, you know, how many people Israel, as they went out. Don't take any food. Go into the desert. Don't take any of your possessions. You see, that's how ridiculous this compromise is. But it is so important. You see, not only is God concerned about your worship and what you'll give to the Lord, he's concerned about your daily bread, right? He's concerned about your daily needs. You see, all these things that you have this morning, your Heavenly Father knows you have need of, and he's given them to you for what reason? There's two verses that kind of put this together, like two opposite poles. Ephesians 4:28 says this. It's about the Christian man or woman. It says, let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, the things which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth it. You see, God is giving you these things. He's giving you the jobs. He's giving you the ability to work. What? So you can help other people. Those that have needs. The other pole you'll find in 1 Thessalonians 4:11. Not only for the needs of others, but for your own needs. 1 Thessalonians 4:11, you see it says, and that you study to be quiet, and to do your own business, and to work with your own hands as we command you. See, God has given us not only the ability to work, all these possessions and the ability to work, these talents, interesting things that we do, to what? Help others. And to bring stuff home for us, to meet our needs, okay? Now, let me ask you here. Turn, if you would, Matthew chapter 6. Getting ahead of ahead of ourselves in the evening service, but I just want to show you something in Matthew chapter 6. See, the question is, how am I to use these things that God has given me to serve Him, to sacrifice, to have this feast? Well, Matthew chapter 6, verse 8, first of all. Notice it says there, "Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of before you ask Him." And we'll look at that as we go on in evening services about prayer. But go to verse 25. "Therefore I say to you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not life more than the meat, and the body more body than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into your barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they? Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take you thought?" Now the word thought means, why are you anxious? You know, worrying. Worrying is sin. Being anxious is a form of unbelief. You see, the Lord is saying, my Heavenly Father owns all the cattle on a thousand hills. If He wanted me to be rich, you know what? I would be rich this morning. And you say, well, what does that mean, to be rich? You see, rich meaning material things? I believe we're quite rich in material things, okay? But we also can be rich in spiritual things. But you see, so these things here, how do I use these things that God gives me? He possesses them all. He owns them all. And He's given them to me on loan, and I'm to be a steward. And then what do? I stay up at night worrying, anxious about these things. Okay? Now, let's just go on for a minute. We'll read this just to see how the Lord Jesus puts it. He says, And why take ye thought, verse 28, for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow, they toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you, that even Solomon, in all his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall ye not much more clothe ye, O ye of little faith? Therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or whether shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of these things." Notice that. Your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of these things. "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof." You see, the compromise is this. You see, you leave all your possessions behind, okay? And you go out and you worship God. And Moses says, no, we can't do that. We're going to take not only our families and our little ones and our children, we're going to take, it says, our flocks, we're going to take our herds, we're going to take everything, not just to sustain me, right? So I can go and eat and get to that 3 days journey. But see, there's going to be, I'm going to be able to use these things, these flocks, these herds, all these possessions for the service of God, for the worship of God. Moses' reply helps us to answer the second question. In what way am I to serve God with these things? Now, look there back in Exodus. Notice, I paraphrased it, but notice what Moses says. When the world says, we're going to tax you to death. We're going to take everything from you. You need to live up to this standard. You need to live up to the American dream or the Canadian dream. Be busy about working, getting possessions and things and all that stuff. So you can be comfortable. And you can give God the leftovers. He's okay with that. No, He's not okay with that. And the mindset of Moses is what we need this morning. And so let's read that. Exodus 10, verse 25. "Thou must give us all So sacrifice and burnt offerings that we may sacrifice unto the Lord our God. Our cattle also shall go with us. There shall not a hoof be left behind. For thereof must we take to serve the Lord our God. And we know not with what we must serve the Lord until we come thither. Notice the three words are there again. You see, we need these possessions so we can sacrifice. We need these possessions so that we can serve, verse 26. And to serve our God, this word savor, we know not what with what. How shall we worship God? You see, they had to go. They said, we're going to bring all the herds, all the flocks. We're going to come 3 days' journey. We're going to get before Mount Sinai. And what's going to happen? We're going to sacrifice. We're going to serve. And what else? We're going to have a feast. And so we can't leave this stuff behind. We can't leave this behind. We can't compromise with. We have to be good stewards and say, what God gives to me, I'm going to use for the promotion and the furtherance of the kingdom. Now, we can't offer up a sacrifice for redemption, though our Lord Jesus has done that, and it's a complete work. You see, but anything that we have this morning, we can offer up to God on His account, through His merit, His work. You see, and that's how we can sacrifice, we can serve, and we can have a feast. And all that we worship before God. Now, why did God give you these things? Why were you born in the West, in the so-called materialistic, blessed part of the world? Why weren't you born in a third world country where there's, you know, abstract poverty in a sense like that? Why has God given you all these possessions? Think about that. Do we have an answer? Well, first, we're not going to leave them to the world. Okay? You see, but as we realize here, what are we to do with these things, that these possessions, what God has given to us on loan, okay, as good stewards? You see, first of all, we can offer ourselves up as living sacrifice in service to God. A living sacrifice in service to God. Turn, if you would, to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Chapter 8 and 9 of 2 Corinthians speaks of what we call grace giving, where we get the doc or the practice of grace giving, no matter how to give, what are we to give in offerings back to God. So the 10% tithe, that's all that's required. No, there's much more than that, okay? 2 Corinthians 8 and 9 speaks of that. But let me read, this attitude about offering ourselves up, okay? And if we offer ourselves up, then all these other things that we have go along with it. Paul says there to the Corinthians, and the Corinthians were kind of, Paul says, I'm going to give you a good example of giving, of a church or people that give, okay? Moreover, brother, we do you to wit of the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. How that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded unto the riches of their liberality. I mean, they gave when they didn't have it to give. Okay? For to their power I bear record, yea, and beyond their power they were willing of themselves, praying us with much entreaty that we would receive the gift and take upon us the fellowship of the ministry of the saints. You see, they said, Paul, we have this offering for you, Paul. We want you to be able to preach the gospel freely. We don't want you working, Paul. We want you out there preaching and establishing churches. And so, Paul, here's this offering. And Paul's saying, how did you come up with this amount? You're in deep poverty. There's great affliction in these churches. But that's where he's getting this. It says, how that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded unto the riches of their liberality. For to their power I bear record, and beyond their power they were willing of themselves. Why is this? Verse 5. And this they did, not as we hoped, but first gave their own selves to the Lord and unto us by the will of God. You see, if we give ourselves first unto the Lord, it's that realization, well, God owns everything. God has given me everything on loan. I'm to be a good steward. And what he gives to me is very important. Now, the idea of leaving things back in Egypt, the possessions and all these things, no. See, the world will say, no. You spend all these possessions on you. You know, you work hard, you live a good life, you've got a nice nest egg, all these things. You just think about yourself first. That's what the world is saying. But see, the Lord says, no, that's not the way we are to be. You see, when we first give ourselves, and God has our heart, then anything that he gives to us, okay, like the saying is, he can give more through us than to us. Now think about it. He can give more through us than he will give to us. There's other verses like Romans 12, 1 and 2. We know them. You know, it says, present yourself as a living sacrifice unto God, which is your reasonable service. You see, offer, say, okay, I'm yours, you owe me, Lord. Okay, what do I do with these things? These blessings. Material, spiritual blessing. All these things. Let me show you another verse and we'll go on as we consider the second question. Hebrews 13, 15 and 16. Notice what it says there. You see, we're talking about sacrifices and worship. What we should do with our gifts. What we should give to the Lord. It says, Hebrews 13, verse 15 says, by him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually, that is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name, but to do good and to communicate, forget not, for with such sacrifices God is well pleased. You see, God is well pleased when we communicate. What does that mean? Well, why did God give me a job? Well, he gave me a job to work. He blessed me with these possessions. Well, what? To see the needs of others. That's what it says. You know, do your almsgiving. That's what we're doing in the evening, right? Your acts of righteousness, and that's particularly to the poor, to the household of faith. When you see brothers and sisters in the Lord struggling, and they've been laid off, or they have medical bills, or this and that, you see, God is expecting us to give. Isn't he? That's what he says. But to do good and to communicate, that means to give financially. For communicate, forget not, for with such sacrifices God is well pleased. You see, what am I supposed to do with these things? Well, the world says, hoard them up, keep them for yourself, eat, drink, and be merry. No, the Lord says, no, you're going to take everything out of the world, what God gives you, and you're going to bring it along, and you're going to get to that 3 days journey, you're going to come before Sinai, and you're going to worship God with these things. You're going to use these things for his promotion, his glory, his honor. Again, I hope the saying, a simple saying, God can give more through you than to you. You can be a channel of blessing. Even as the Apostle Paul, and it's interesting saying, he says, the Lord Jesus said this, it is more blessed to give than to receive. A good steward, as good stewards, we are to use what God gives us for the furtherance of his glory, his kingdom, and honor. Now you know the illustration, for time's sake I won't go there, but Matthew 25, the illustration of how the king goes off into a far country and he gives what? His servants talents. Some 10, 5, and 1, okay? And eventually the Lord comes back, the king comes back, and he says, okay, let's give it accountability, okay? And the one man who had 10 gained 10 more, the other man gained 5, he gained 5 more. What did the one do with the one? Well, He feared God. No, he said, I feared that you're an austere man, and what I did, I buried it, and the Lord of the master said, why didn't you put it in the bank? At least you could have got usury or interest. And so the illustration is, for us, what talents has God given to you? What gifts and ability? What measure of prosperity? Your good health. What is that for? The abilities that God has given you. What are they for? To leave them back in Egypt? To waste them on ourselves? You see, we have to remember that there's going to be accountability for our stewardship. Hope we're not like that one illustration the Lord gives. You see, I think it's in Gospel of Luke where the steward knows that he's going to be accountable and he's going to give an account to the Lord. And so he calls in the debtors, right? He calls in the debtors, and one guy owes 100 barrels of wheat or something, and he marks it down to 60. It's not going to happen that way. You see, we're going to have to be good stewards. We're going to be accountable for what God gives to us and through us. That's going to be talents, gifts, not just money. Talents, gifts, prosperity, health, everything. You know, I got a good IQ. You know, I got a good brain. I can think. I can understand. You know, I'm educated. Well, what are you going to use that? How are you going to use that? Who gave you that to you? I have good health. Who gave that to you? I have the ability to work. Who gave that to you? What are you going to use it for? We're going to be accountable, but also, this is really amazing, we're going to be rewarded for being faithful stewards. In the book of Matthew that we're going in the evening, it says, you do your alms and your prayer in secret, what happens? God rewards you openly. Well, that's when I get to heaven. No. Not so. Not all of it. You know, there is going to be the Bema judgment. There's going to be the rewards banquet that we talked about. But you see, here is what we are to do. The second question, what am I supposed to do with all these things? Well, God has given them to me. They're on loan. I'm going to be a good steward. And I'm going to use them for His advancement, His kingdom, the needs of His people. My needs too, right? Give us this day our daily bread. I have needs, you have needs, but you see, the world says, use them for you. Don't use them for the work of God. Think about yourself first. And we can't do that. We can't do that. Let's close with the last question. And I think it's a warning. You can't take these things with you. You know, I don't know if you've ever seen the bumper sticker. You know, he with the most toys in the end wins. He with the most toys in the end. He's talking about adults. He that with the most toys in the end wins. So when Jesus says in Luke 12:15, he says, beware of covetousness. Take heed, beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of things which he possesseth. And the Lord gives this illustration. You know the illustration about the man who has, you know, he's prosperous. He says, okay, eat, drink, be merry. Let's build bigger barns and more barns and put more stuff in them. And, you know, what am I going to do with all this stuff that I got? See, I got the white shed. I have the barn. Cleaned out the cellar. But you know, with 10 people, 12 people in the family, well, we sure do accumulate a lot of stuff. I said, you know, the problem is I haven't moved in a while. You see, when you move, you say, this is important, this gets junked. This, I don't need these things. You see, but see, sometimes we're just swimming in it. We don't know what to do with it. Now maybe you say, "Well, I don't have that problem." I hope you don't. But it does. It says, "Beware of covetousness. Beware of covetousness. Trust not in uncertain riches." That's the next point here. You see the warning. Okay, beware of covetousness. You can't take these things with you. You see, trust not in uncertain riches. And there's a lot of verses. We could go to 1 Timothy. I'll save them for you to read. 1 Timothy 6. 6 through 10, 17 through 19 talks about the love of money, the root of all evil. And see, it's not wrong to be rich, is it? No, the Lord says in 1 Timothy 6, 17, He says He's given us all these things to richly enjoy. And so here we are, and brethren, you might, you know, we may not think it. You know, we might be trying to scratch out an existence in this Canada, okay? But you see, we are prosperous. We are, you know, we're not a third, fourth world country. You see, we make, in a sense, good wages. You see, and I always remember what Brother George said, you know, when he went over to where Romania, Russia areas, like, you know, going to the grocery store or going to the hardware store, you know, you get a little ticket saying that you can get bread today, and by the time you get to the checkout thing, there's no bread left. Do we have a problem with that down at Food Basics or all the other? Some of the people that around the world, they would come to us, they would come to Canada or the United States and go to our grocery stores, go to the Walmarts, go to these places, and they would say, I've died and gone to heaven. But it's the Laodicean attitude that's killing us, isn't it? I have everything, I need nothing. In other words, Jesus says, you are blind, you're naked, you're miserable, wretched. Don't trust in uncertain riches. If God has blessed you, then you say, Lord, what do I do with these things? You're going to give an account for them? Okay? God is going to reward you for them? And finally, in closing, Moses says something so neat. Go there, Exodus 10. And we'll just say this and we'll be done. Exodus 10, verse 25 through 26. See, God gives us everything in this world to richly enjoy. For our needs, for the needs of others, for the furtherance of the kingdom, for the gospel, for the needs of the local church. But I like what Moses says there in verse 26. He says, our cattle also shall go with us. There shall not a hoof be left behind. Isn't that good? That's the mindset we should have. You see, we think about how am I allowing the world to not allow me to have my possessions? You see, we're to go into Canaan land, we're to possess our possessions. And I'm not talking about the health and wealth gospel, prosperity. No. You see, have I allowed Satan to get hold of my finances, unwise decisions, leaving myself open to his attack? Or maybe I'm just directing my life towards the Canadian dream. You know, I want the car, I want the house, I want the prosperity, I want the 401k and all these things. I want these things because I live in the land of the free. That's all mine. Moses says, I'm not going to leave a hoof out. I'm not a hoof be left behind. And what is Moses saying? I'm going to take everything. I don't know, put them before the Lord and say, Lord, how am I going to sacrifice these things for your glory and honor? How am I going to use these things for your service? And how am I going to feast and enjoy these things in some ways? But the idea is this. God will give more what? Through you than to you. Are you trusting in uncertain riches this morning? How big is your bank account in heaven? What is God giving you these blessings and material things, these talents? I'm not just talking about material things. You see, God is giving you an intellect. God is giving you musical abilities. God is giving you administration abilities. All kinds of things. You know, every one of you that are saved this morning has a gift to be used in the local church. You know that? Do you know what your gifts are? Are you using them? Or have you buried them? You put them in the ground. And for different reasons, you know, brethren, I could have never imagined standing up here 30 years ago preaching the Word of God, or preaching, or pastoring. That would have been, I'd probably get to the mark. You know, the first thing, getting married to Kathy was like, the possibility of getting married to Kathy was like, I probably could have gone to the moon next. You know, I would have been have better chances going to the moon than getting Kathy as my wife. The second thing is, like, preaching, standing up here, me doing this? I hated that, George. I wanted to be off in the corner. I want nothing to do with that. Me and myself, God's sake, I can pass out tracts, but get in front of people, forget that. What has God done? He's given me jobs to provide for me, but he says, Tom, you're going to have to speak. You're going to have to be a phone salesman. You're going to have to teach people, young people. You have to get in front of people. And so the Lord has worked through that too. But you see, I don't want to bury my talent. I want to use my gift to the fullest, even when it hurts. And personality-wise, I don't want to do that. But you see, that's what God has given to us. So here, Moses is giving us the conclusion. Thou must give us also sacrifices and burnt offerings, that we may sacrifice unto the Lord our God. Our cattle also shall go with us. There shall not a hoof be left behind, for thereof must we take to serve the Lord our God. And we know not what we must serve the Lord until come hither. Now, is that true for us this morning? Do we have to wait till we come to Sinai? No. The cross is already history, in a sense. It's a fact. We have been called out. We were redeemed. We're worshiping the Lord. We're serving the Lord. We're sacrificing with the Lord. We know what we're supposed to do with all these things, right? Do we? May the Lord give us grace to actually practice that. Is that true? Give us grace to practice good stewardship for the glory of God. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time. Lord, let us not be like the Laodicean church. Father, we do need that goal. We need that persecution. We would evaluate our lives rightly. We need that white raiment that we might be clothed, that the shame of our nakedness would not be seen. Father, we need that eye salve this morning. Lord, you have blessed us. You have given us much things, many things. And yes, there are many things that are really enjoyable. But Lord, you know also that it's prone to make us weak, indifferent, fat, indulgent, undisciplined. Father, you've given us these things. The world wants to take them from us, whether it's taxation or unfair wages or all kinds of things, Lord, even where we would spend it unwisely. Father, we ask for stewardship, grace to be good stewards. Father, we thank you for all that you've given to us. We want to give it back to you. We want to be good stewards. So bless now, we pray. Help us, O Lord, to consider these things. For we ask these things in Jesus' name.